Welcome back. I am UX Sathe, Assistant Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Walchand Institute of Technology. Now this is fifth session. Already in last four sessions, we have studied a lot about basics of thermodynamics. Now we are studying applications. And as usual, before going to discuss, we will see what are the outcomes, what is the expected outcomes of this. So at the end of this session, you will be able to derive the expression for efficiency of heat engine. You will be able to analyze various statements of second law of thermodynamics, and you will apply Carnot theorem. Now see, first of all, let us recall what we have studied. We have seen in the first video, second video and third video onwards, the heat, work, which are forms of energies, the first statement of first law of thermodynamics, the conservation principle and the first law are equivalent. And also we have seen that first law has got a limitation. That is, if you do the process in one direction, there is no guarantee that process will be there in the reverse direction. Now today we are going to see the heat engine, how it operates and how to find out the efficiency of heat engine. Now let us see, if I draw a PV diagram, and let us say this is my one process, say path A from 1 to 2. Now looking at this process 1 to 2, immediately the question comes to your mind that this is volume V1, this is volume V2. Now what is happening to the volume? Volume is getting decreased. Now decrease in volume will never be automatic. For the decrease of volume, we require certain work. So we have to spend work. Means when I go from V1 to V2, there is a reduction in volume. There is a reduction in volume, and reduction in volume requires work. It requires work. Means this process 1 to 2 will consume work. Okay, there is no problem for it. But now suppose I come from process 2 to 1, by process say path B, then immediately we know that now for this process there is an increase in volume. Now as there is increase in volume, we say that the net work done by this particular cycle, now see the word what I am using, cycle, is the area of the PV diagram. Now this is a loop, and if this loop is existing and if I have a cycle which is in the clockwise direction, see the direction, I will get work output. So we have decided that clockwise is work, cycle is work producing, it is work producing machine, it is work producing machine. Now when I go from 1 to 2 and I get from 2 to 3, there are two quantities which are important. One is the Q1 and second is Q2. Now whether I supply heat or heat is rejected, that will decide how much amount of work I am going to get. Now looking at the diagram, you can see that 1 to 2 is a compression. This can be obtained either with the help of a work or heat, but you know that out of work and heat, work is superior. So as far as possible, if you use heat and that work can be done, that particular task can be completed by heat, it is well and good. If we have heat and work option, but work, that particular process cannot be carried out, say with the help of heat, then only use the work. So without, say, loss of generality, we assume that Q1 is heat supplied. Q1 is heat supplied. And Q2 is expansion, so it is heat rejected. Heat rejected. Now the definition of a thermal efficiency in general is work done upon heat supplied. Now what is work done? Q1 minus Q2. Because finally, whatever amount of heat I have supplied and whatever amount of heat I am getting rejected, so Q1 minus Q2 is the work done upon heat supplied is Q1. So I will get 1 minus Q2 by Q1 as the efficiency. Now this is very fundamental. Now if we go to another, say, basic principle about the, say, efficiency, you will find that when efficiency I write as 1 minus Q2 by Q1, if it is equal to 1, its meaning is Q2 is 0. Now if I am not rejecting heat, then only I can get the conversion of entire amount of heat supplied into work, which is against the first law of thermodynamics. Means we cannot have perpetual motion machine of first kind. Okay. Now this is about the heat engine. Now go to the important topic, that is second law of thermodynamics. Second law. See, historically, say second law was developed first, because it was responsible person was Carnot, who was a engineer. Now the second law is important from the point of view of say feasibility of a process. So there are various versions of the process, that if I say that if I want to go from the point 1 to point 2, point 1 to point 2, the problem is whether this process would occur or not. And if I come from 2 to 1 again, so the feasibility of this cycle is judged by second law. That is one thing. And second law is a common day experience, that whenever heat transfers, it is from high temperature to low temperature. Whenever there is a flow of fluid, it is from high pressure to low pressure. Whenever there is a concentration difference, then high concentration to low concentration, there is a mixing. Means there is a potential difference. What is important? There is a potential difference for the process to occur, and always it is from high potential to low potential. So high to low is a natural, and we cannot come from low to high, say, without expending energy. So looking at this particular say phenomena, there are various statements given by various say scientists. One is a Clausius statement. Now this Clausius statement says that if you want to transfer heat, there are two bodies, one is at T1 and second is at T2, and assume that say T1 is less than T2. If T1 is less than T2, and if I want to transfer heat from T1 to T2. Now just imagine you have two buckets in which one water is having 30 degrees, another bucket water is having at say 60 degree temperature. You connect a copper rod and expect that heat is being transferred from low temperature to high temperature. Will it happen in nature? Never. Because we know that there is a temperature difference, and it will not happen on its own. So Clausius said that it is not possible operating in a cycle, which is important word, cycle. In a single process, it is possible that we can convert entire amount of heat into work. I give a simple example. If I have got an isothermal process, say isothermal expansion or isothermal compression, whatever it may be. Now here what happens? If I take isothermal expansion, means I have to supply heat. And expansion gives me work. First law says that Q minus W is equal to delta U. Delta U is equal to 0 for isothermal. So Q is equal to W. So a student may be confused that for an isothermal expansion, I get Q is equal to W, means whatever amount of heat I have supplied, I have converted into work. Then it is a violation of the Clausius statement, or violation of the say conversion of entire amount of heat into work. But remember, all these laws, second laws, statements are specific to the cycle. Means if you operate anything in a cycle, you will never get transfer of, you will never transfer heat from low temperature to high temperature without expenditure of energy. So this is the Clausius statement. Now what is the consequence of this? You know that in a refrigerator, this is temperature say T1, this is temperature T2. T1 is less than T2, I have to transfer this heat or remove the heat from this say amount of Q and transfer it to the higher temperature reservoir. Then for this I must spend certain amount of work. Now when this work is shown, then it says that, Clausius says that it is possible, because what you are doing now, you are removing heat from a temperature reservoir which is at low temperature to higher temperature by consuming some amount of work. So it is not against second law of thermodynamics, and you are operating in a cycle. Similarly, suppose I have got a reservoir at some temperature T1, I remove it and say some amount of Q, and I can completely convert it into work. So what is this? This is engine. So whatever amount of heat you have taken, you have converted into work. So this is a Kelvin Planck statement. So Kelvin Planck statement says that in a cycle you cannot remove heat from a single reservoir and convert it entirely into work without rejecting it to the sink. So naturally the sink is mandatory for the cycle to operate. When we do this, some amount of heat will be taken, some amount of heat will be rejected, and we will get the heat transfer. Now third point is the Carnot cycle. If you draw it on the PV diagram, you will find that it consists of four cycles. So this is PV is equal to constant, and this is also PV is equal to constant. This is PV raised to gamma is equal to constant, and this is PV raised to gamma is equal to constant. So this is isothermal expansion followed by adiabatic expansion, isothermal compression followed by adiabatic compression. And you know that isothermal and adiabatic, it is a very slow process, it is very fast process. So coupling of slow and fast is impossible. If you find out the expression for the efficiency of a Carnot cycle using the same, that is heat supplied upon say efficiency is equal to work done upon heat supplied, you will get 1 minus T2 by T1, where T1 is greater than T2. And there is a limit that if T2 and T1 are in absolute degree and we cannot have T2 equal to T1, then efficiency is 0, there is no work done. If T2 is equal to 0, that is absolute 0, we can get efficiency is equal to 1, which is not possible, and that is perpetual motion machine of second kind is impossible. Now the detail about the machine and its application we will see in the next videos. Those who are interested in studying further, they can refer to the standard books available. Say references are Thermodynamics by P.K. Nag and Thermodynamics by Eunice Senjal. Thank you for patient hearing.